This is not your mama's poetry event. It's more like a tent revival. If you hear something you like, give a shout out. If you're not a shouter, you can snap in agreement. If you want to clap after a performance, though, you definitely can. So I'm going to start the evening off by reading two poems. Maybe three if you're lucky. The first is Gary Snyder's How Poetry Comes to Me. Are we going to have this issue? How poetry comes to me. It comes blundering over the boulders at night. It stays frightened outside the range of my campfire. I go to meet it at the edge of the light. And now I'll read Ferlinghetti's Constantly Risking Absurdity. Constantly risking absurdity and death whenever he performs above the heads of his audience, the poet, like an acrobat, climbs on rhyme to a high wire of his own making and, balancing on I-beams above a sea of faces, paces his way to the other side of the day, performing entrachets and sleight of foot tricks and all without and other high theatrics and all without mistaking anything for what it may not be, for he's the super realist who must perforce perceive taught truth before the taking of each stance or step in his supposed advance toward that still higher perch where beauty stands and waits with gravity to start her death-defying leap. And he, a little Charlie Chaplin man, who may or may not catch her fair eternal form, spread-eagled in the empty air of existence. And finally, I will read for you my favorite poem by Mae Swenson, who is not a beat poet, but who was their contemporary. It's one of my favorite poems because it is called Deciding, and I think it's a coming out poem. Deciding to go on digging, doing it. What they said outside wasn't any use. Inside, hiding it made it get ambitious, like a potato in a dark bin. It grew white grabbers for light out of its navel eyes, not priding itself much, just deciding. It wasn't true inside what they said. Outside, those bumps were all humped alike, dumped inside, slumped in burlap, said roots are no good out of ground. A fruit's crazy to want to be a flower. Besides, it's sin changing the given shape. Bursting the old brown skin is suicide. Wishing to taste like a tulip, sip colored light. Outside thump said it isn't right. Deciding to keep on striding from inside, bursting the bin side, poking out wishes for delicious opposites, turning blind eyes to strong fingers, touching meaning more than sight. The navel scars of weaning used for something, finally. Deciding to go on digging. Doing it. I am pleased to introduce our featured performer, Inti Khanna. Inti Khanna is a national award-winning writer and performer of the critically acclaimed one-man hip-hop musical Penumbra, described as bold, daring, fearless, truly innovative by HBO deaf poetry producer Camila Forbes. Directed by Shindan Majidi, Penumbra utilizes elements of hip-hop, spoken word, theater, film, and photography to illustrate the life of a young Boricua who grows up in the Bronx and powerfully confronts issues concerning family, social injustice, and self-identity. Inti Khanna has been featured on VH1 and toured across the United States, Cuba, Costa Rica, Ecuador, Peru, and Colombia while sharing the stage with artists such as KRS-One, Immortal Technique, Talib Kweli, Lupe Fiasco, M1 of Dead Prez, among many others. He is a two-time ACUI Northeast Collegiate Regional Poetry Slam champion and recipient of 6 ACUI National Collegiate Poetry Slam awards, including Best Flow, Rookie of the Year, All Around Badass, that's my favorite, among others. As an Urban Word NYC mentor and member of the Rebel Diaz Arts Collective in the South Bronx, Inti Khanna has performed and facilitated workshops at over 100 universities, colleges, educational institutions, and prison facilities. Please join with me in welcoming Inti Khanna.
sound people. Could I get someone to help me over here? So, all right, yeah, I'll save the music for later. How's everybody doing? Seriously, though. Is Utah here? Where y'all from outside of Utah? Connecticut, Texas. Cali, I love Cali. Cali's like my second home. Canada. Idaho, woo! Peel more skins than Idaho potatoes, what? New York City, where's New York City at? All right, damn, that was, see, Miami, Florida, okay. See, when you're in New York City and you say, yo, where you from? You know, you say, Brooklyn, people wild out, tables break and stuff happens, but I'm from the Bronx. Yeah, if you can find, not yet, but if you find Arizona/perform somewhere in, oh, actually, no, I know what it was. I got it. I remember now. Sorry. I apologize for the delay, but now I know. Yes. Man, it's a lot. All right. What is freedom? Is it a thought, word, a dream? Can it be none of the above or all three? Is it something we all have but can't see? Is it only for a few? Is there enough for me? If nothing in this life is free, what's the price that we have to pay to be? Is it a choice? Is it given? Is it taken? Is it worth it? What does it look like? Where can I find it? Is it in the projects? Is it out on Wall Street? Is it on a hammock over water at a far beach? A baby in a stroller with a mother that could feed her, who doesn't have to raise a voice, lay a hand and beat her the way she was repeatedly addicted to a needle. A father who could be honest and promising to teach her, teachers who could reach her. Has she seeking for a reason more than a score off a test quiz? A regents, there's a meaning she could feel it. She's dreaming and she means it, meaning she could be it if given the means to see it. Quiet in the back of the class, too shy to raise a hand. Most see youth as kids, but they're greater. They're reflections of us. They descended from us, the us that we were when we were who we were. It's absurd when an elder tries to minimize their worth, holding on to wisdom with them, wishing they could learn, pass it on. It's important. They're starving for the knowledge. Change comes with time. It's not an action. It's a process. It's more than just marching. It's what you do after the protest. It's giving back to the hood. That makes you conscious. What makes an activist activate when they graduate with a bachelor's over masters from the masters with a master's screaming massive all the answers when they've mastered it. We could shape the world if we could try to change how we imagine it. It's okay to make mistakes, but if freedom's what they say, we don't got time to waste. Oh, we gotta turn the music up. A little bit louder. Can we turn that music louder? I miss my DJ. My DJ is somewhere in the Bronx right now. I really miss him. All right. Louder, bump it. Bump it. Bump my music. All right, that's better. All right, here we go. Arizona.
This is for the workers, the purpose, the children, hungry, the women, exploited labor, and boggles, the empty bellies, the father, trying to feed his family dirt in his fingernails, and he's undocumented. That he doesn't exist. The students at Puerto Rico, Arizona, SB1070, illegalizing humanity. Shoulder to shoulder, regardless of gender or color, we gon' march in unison. From the jam, brewer, and the racist movement, and we got this pendant. Siempre resistencia.
Keep on marching, keep climbing, keep fighting. And we gon' keep on coming, keep building, keep working.
Yeah, I feel that.
We gon' keep on marching, keep climbing, keep fighting. And we gon' keep on coming, keep building, keep working.
the Mexican-American War of 1846 to 1848, the United States invaded Mexico, disregarding its native immigration laws, forcing Mexico to sell half its territory, including Texas, California, Nevada, Wyoming, Colorado, New Mexico, Utah, and Arizona. The reality is we sit on stolen land. Now it's our time to stand up and take it back. And we gon' keep on marching, keep climbing, keep fighting. And we gon' keep on coming, keep building, keep working. Where y'all at? And we gon' keep on marching, keep climbing, keep fighting. And we gon' keep on coming, keep building, keep working. That's a song I did featuring a group called Navegante. I have CDs in the back of that music. We're actually doing a dope music video, documentary style. So I don't know what y'all feelings are on people being abused and exploited, but I have strong feelings. Can I take a chance with y'all? All right, here we go. I have a song. I'm gonna keep it short, because I'm about to do a whole play. Y'all gonna stick around for the play, right? I have a play called Penumbra. In Spanish, it's Penumbra. Una sombra de una sombra. A shadow of a shadow. I'm gonna do that whole play for y'all, which is a lot of work, so I'm gonna keep this short, and we're gonna keep it rolling. We're gonna hear other poets, and we're gonna support them, because I don't know how many of y'all ever been on stage, but, you know, some people definitely need the extra support, and regardless, we're gonna show support whether they need it or not, because we're dope human beings like that, right? So, this song I've never performed publicly. So I'm taking a huge chance. I wasn't gonna perform it, but I was like, man, I think it'd be dope to share. The weather outside was nice today. Back home in New York City is kind of whack. The weather's rainy and cold. And I live in the South Bronx, so right now it's kind of like, you know, just, I mean, it could be inspiring depending on how you look at it, but I like good weather. That's why I like California. Woo! And I like y'all too. All right, here's the song. I'm gonna try this with y'all, man. I hope I could do this. All right. Have you ever watched the sunset where the FDR meets the Brooklyn Bridge, shining through the projects, 14 flights up in the LES? Or better yet, at a barbecue on my DJ's rooftop in the South Bronx. If you have, then you'll notice there's a point in which the sky changes colors. The view of the once blue alters you beyond the full moon and blends with the reddish orange. It's like the sun is making love with this planet Earth, a long distant relationship that actually works. Have you ever taken time to count the stars lying on your back? It's like they're looking down. It's moments like this that make me feel and be proud to be alive. They don't come by every day, so I hold them tight. If I died right now, I think I'd be okay. Now here's the hook, y'all ready? Maybe I can do it, it's simple. The sky looks different today. The sky looks different today. I don't know why, but the sky looks different today. The sky looks different today. Don't know what it is, but the sky looks different today. The sky looks different today. I wish I didn't need a camera to save these moments. Instead, simply memorize them with my eyes open. I can't explain it, the feeling's euphoric. I may not have the key, but I can help to show you where the door is. This life's the illest puzzle. Just check the field of pieces. Take a step back, see the bigger picture. If you ain't living your fullest potential, what's the reason? I gotta make it, I promise. My mama's banking on it. In fact, let me call her now, tell her that I love her. Send a postcard from the road, maybe send some flowers. I may not know about my great-grandmother, but I do know that my grandmother's great. She's the reason my family is still a family. Despite everything, she loves us unconditionally. Despite the arguments, tribulations, and craziness. Despite the horrors, the memories that made us this. Beautifully beautiful portrait.
composed it in my mind. Let me take a second, so he sets her mind. Y'all feeling that?
That's what's up. Maybe I can do this with me.
The sky looks different today. The sky looks different today. I don't know why, but the sky looks different today. The sky looks different today. Don't know what it is, but the sky looks different today. The sky looks different today.
Man, got me premiering music in Utah. Man. All right. That's off a new project that I'm working on with my DJ who's not here. Can y'all send him some spiritual love to my DJ out in the Bronx? DJ Charlie Hustle. We're working on a project called Master Cleanse. The idea of cleansing ourselves from our masters and our oppressors and cleaning out ourselves spiritually, politically, and in all ways that can hopefully be beautiful. And the play entitled Penumbra, which I'm going to perform for y'all. I got CDs in the back. Come check them out. And I do take credit cards. I can finally say that. Took me a long time to say that. But I do take credit cards. That's funny.
I take EBT. I take food stamps. I take all that. You know what I'm saying?
And I got free stickers. If y'all are broke, how many of y'all are broke college students? Y'all weren't supposed to admit it. I have free stickers if y'all want. I got music you can download for free as well on my website. I got an email list. If you do buy a CD, which is only $10, it comes with a poster. You can buy both for $15. I think it's pretty fair. So I got mad love for y'all. I'm going to perform my play. I usually don't talk before my play, so this is exciting. So thank y'all for being present. Make sure y'all give it up for the MC, the lovely host, and the future poets that are going to be performing tonight, and just show them infinite love. Enjoy your mugs. Enjoy the art and show love.
That was just a little teaser of more to come. Teaser, teaser. I want to take just a second to thank our sponsors, the University Inn and Conference Center, USU Writing Center, Cafe Ibis, ASUSU, the Chass Council, the Access and Diversity Center, and University Catering and Dining Services. And how about that team of coffee makers running for all of you? I was worried I might have to translate when he says, "Are you all hearing that?" He means sing the chorus too. But you got it at the end, so that's good. I'm pleased now to introduce our next performer, and actually, I think sort of the brains behind this this event, Chase Casillas. Originally hailing from the border town of McAllen, Texas, Chase grew up with an unconventional background. Surrounded by a different culture and the violence of gangs and drug trafficking, he had to learn to grow up differently than most. He found refuge from his daily settings through the music of the punk and hardcore scene, and it has transcended through all aspects of his life, especially his writing. Through this music, he has learned self-empowerment and wants to share it with everyone he interacts with. Tonight, he will perform his most personal and revealing work to date with selections from his work titled The Hangover Hymns, The Rise and Fall of Cindy's Son, which implements the aspects of poetry and the music he grew up loving. Chase.
Right. To all the shit talkers and social media stalkers, it's time to turn my ears and give a weapon to those depressed. Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, I became suicidal at 7 and woke up unsuccessful on the floor a few times before I ever turned 24. It was in between the designer drugs and fake hugs that I learned how fake they actually were, leaving me medicated from what they fabricated. Well, I am taking it back. A self-serving lesson for those tainted, finding excuses for what others lack. Using words as weapon, this is a full-blown assault, and I swear on a stack of the King James Bibles that I will have my day, because you have given me a sinking feeling that could rival Atlantis! And you can bet that I will take down the terrorists of talking. It's time to let them do the middle finger math. Ante up and let the truth consume them. Listen, you hot little hate junkies. You are Icarus, I am the sun. Through the streets, you can tear them apart. Time to harness the power. Damn it, kid, show them you have heart. And that this life was all yours from the start. It's time to let you realize that you are all the king of consequence and the pharaohs of fucking awesome. And let all that hate condense and finally let everyone have a piece of some. Because if people hate you for nothing, then you must be doing something right. Because the closing argument is they would all be murderers if they weren't all talk. Yeah! Thanks, guys. That was slander and libel attorneys at law. And that is more or less, don't let other people's shit get you down. There's a lot of talk in college, and it's going to happen. There's a lot of talk everywhere, if you look at it. So a little bit about me. I'm Chase Casillas. I was born in McAllen, Texas, really close to the border. And I'm vulgar. My humor is really perverted. And I got that from my family, and I wouldn't have it any other way. But what a lot of people don't know about me is the misconception about my size. They think I'm honestly big and dumb. And I'm sick of it. You know, like you're walking down the hall like, hey, you know, imagine if you're a little person and someone goes, hey, little guy, how you doing? You're so small. Imagine, hey, big guy, you're a freaking retard. I hate it. And that word's not PC either. But that's just to give you a point. So I had to grow up fast where I grew up. And honestly, the best way to do that was following my icon, Arnold Schwarzenegger. It's what happened. But it's kind of a dark road to get there. And there's a lot of things that can happen. Especially, I don't know if anyone has ever wished death on somebody. But when it actually happens to my seventh grade bully in a gang fight, doesn't feel too good. So, this next one's about preconceived notions, and it's kind of a self-portrait, but hopefully you guys can apply it to yourself. And that one is Cybertron, Mitch. This is the story of a boy turned beast. Humble beginning turned big, a gentle giant was sleepy, with wrecking ball hands weighing over 305 and somehow still alive. Peaceful in my demeanor, but like anything, strange attention is drawn. Put me under a microscope, slowly vying to see what others could spawn. Despise the manuscripts of Beowulf, because I grew up as Grendel. Misunderstood big, presumed dumb at first glance. It helped me to become self-aware, and that my choosing, I could put you in an ambulance. I aspired to be a lover, but the world made me a fighter. A flare of Western testosterone and the taste for American mischief. I'll burn your cities to the ground. With HGH pumping through my veins, I am everything your assumption wants me to be. Who you gonna call? It's an undefeatable masculinity rising. Young hearts defeat tonight as you let me unleash the beast. Sexual pun. And I will find your poor excuse for men and string them up by their feet. Because you know hipster meat? That tastes so sweet. a party animal gone rabid, a child instilled a rage, a hot tub Casanova, a complete trash coma. Somewhere over the Rambo, men like me still exist to know that a six-pack never saved a goddamn life, to embrace palm-bleeding high fives as well. Until then, I will assemble an army of those left to crush those in bedazzled and embellished ass jeans, to take back what was rightfully ours at the beginning of time, reclaiming the right to have bare arms. That one was called The Modern Monster, because that's what I feel like I am. So, right now, this show's not about me anymore. It's about you. How many people came here to sort of vent or listen to other people vent? Who did? Louder. What part of the introduction didn't you hear? I said, I am influenced by hardcore. That means you gotta be so loud. Who came to vent tonight? Okay, so this is where the show turns to you. I'm gonna point at one section of the crowd, starting over here, and over here. Each time I point my finger that way, one person, or you know, if someone else beats you to the punch, go ahead and say it anyway. Say something you would change about this world. Not your life, about this world, how you can contribute. Over here. Homophobia, right here. Over here. Old cheese. Let's hit the house lights. I want to make sure everyone's doing this. One more time, over here. Over here. Now, over here. Now, everyone stand the hell up. Everyone stand up. All right. Here's what we're going to do. On the count of three, I know you all have it inside, and this is a way of making you comfortable. On the count of three, you're gonna say the one thing about the world you want to change. So, if I said on three, I say I want there to be no more immigration laws that send people like my parents back to Mexico. You say what you wanna say on the count of three. Ready? One, two, I better hear you. Three! Do you hear that? Do you hear that? Hit it. What you have done is started the seeds of change. You have changed the tides and gone back to the beginning. It is your time now to change the world. So clap with me. Look at the person next to you, because in the end, it's us that matters. No one else. This is your time. You are here now. You have the power to change the world. Nobody else. If you're not happy with your life, it's your responsibility to go out there and take care of it. Take it. Take it in your hands. It's yours. The future belongs to no one else, and it has never been written. This is your time, and all that matters is us in the end. Everyone say that with me. All that matters is us. Ready? One, two, three. All that matters is us. One more time. One, two, three. All that matters is us. Thank you, Utah State. Enjoy everyone else.
Wow. See, I told you you'd probably like him. The next section of our evening is a section of local poets, and I again have the pleasure of introducing them. First of all, we'll have Isaac Tim, and he will read Antiseptic and Obligatory Rose Poem. Isaac was born and raised in the town of Kaleo in the West Desert of Utah, a stop on the historic Pony Express Trail. His highest aspiration is to be a storyteller like his father. He is a returning student and has a dual major in history and creative writing. Isaac.
Yeah. My dad can't be here today, but he started this when he was 19, dressed in his turtleneck. He wanted to be a beatnik, but they sent him to Vietnam. And I went, sorry. And I go to school, and I learn to speak so I can tell what he said. And I want this to go out to him. This goes out to my father, the roughneck. He read books to us, and the food stamp holidays. Woo! Thank you. All right, that's out. All right. I don't know about that. First poem, antiseptic. Hot nurse with such light scrubs, lay your healing hands on me. At 16, I am goosebumps in my bare feet and gown. Hot nurse leans over, smells of lilac, not nurse, but doctor. I'm embarrassed, such a crumb to assume all women nurses. Hot doctor with such light scrubs, lay your healing hands on me. She does her tests with a rubber hammer, then warm hands in mine, testing my strength, my power, how well I can push and pull. Adolescent male, Becker's MD, no noticeable change since last. She smiles with her perfect teeth, coyly over note page and leaves. I feel warm and flush. I kick up my feet, almost knock over a tray. She comes back in very grave. She has caught me. Now, punishment. Looking to her right to see if we're alone, and then comes in unsure. All those teeth again, but no follow through to deep green eyes. Then she blurts out, I don't know if this has been addressed to you, but it'd be unwise for you to have children. Then pausing, there's no change in your health that I've found. Here's the attending. From the right comes the boss doctor in his long coat, so crisp and white. He smiles at her, approving of a hard job so well done by a young intern. She does not look back, just leaves in her path lilac over antiseptic. Obligatory rose poem. If roses have hips, then shouldn't they have feet that carry them in the wind, give them a swerve, make a man stand up and pay attention with the sound of a swift needle heel stiletto, tempo on tile, a straight forward. Here she is, stride, an echo that demands eyes all the way up the stem to a figure well fit into a tailor red coat. Bobbed hair, short skirt creates the movement that drives a man to write a poem.
How about our local poets, huh? Woo! Next up, we have Brian Cook, who grew up in Vernal, Utah. Everybody loves Vernal that I know. He grew up in Vernal, where he learned everything there is to know about cows and sagebrush. Terrified of these things, he turned to poetry as an escape. Since then, Brian has won first place in the USU Scribendi Creative Writing Contest in both poetry and nonfiction. He has recently been published in Sigma Tau Delta's The Rectangle. He also performs improv comedy with The Antics. Maybe you've seen him. Graduating in May, Brian plans to eventually work towards an MFA in creative writing. With all this, he has never written about cows nor sagebrush. Brian Cook.
This is my crutch, just in case. But seriously, guys, I'm really glad to be here. Does this thing work? It works much better than I expected. So yes, I'm Brian Cook.
good. This is gonna be awesome. Right, so my first poem is called Tongue Bird. I was born colorblind, raised surrounded by white padded walls. I just sit there, staring at my fingers because they were so different from the world. I pressed them together, rubbed the thin coat of oil between the canyons of my fingerprints, stuck them in my mouth, and tasted humanity. I started to see in three dimensions, width, height, but especially depth, casting my mind down wishing wells, hoping my wishes would keep it from scraping the sides. The splash rang for a decade, grew like a hurricane, whiplashing away the smoke glass perched on my eyes. I stood up, shook off the dust of my solitude, and walked out the door like Gloria Gaynor. The sky throbbed like a parachute, white clouds puffed up. My pants shook full of moths, beating their rhythmic wings against my legs as my feet hit the floor in a golden mashed potato jive. I sliced those strings, sewing my lips shut, and color shot out of my mouth like a cuckoo clock. I cut that tongue bird loose and watched it streak the sky with juicy, vivid reds and yellows that you could just sink your teeth into and taste as the magic crackled like a sparkler down your throat. All we are is color. Blue reflected off a skin of water stretched out across an abandoned highway. Red sliced from a drop of sunshine, lapping up flaming gorges, glowing sandstone. Even the colorblind can feel golden notes in F-sharp major slide into their ears, down to their souls. And the deaf can feel the ochre pine sap seep into their hands as they tap out the rhythm of the trees, shaking in the wind, their leaves dropping on us like a balm of gratitude. And every color crawls into us until a doctor doing an autopsy on our bodies would piss his pants as his sterile coat and latex gloves became splattered with life from a yellow brain, blue liver, purple pancreas. I've stood in a golden wheat field and watched the first crystal drops of water pluck at my cheeks as I plucked my own heart out, thrusting it into the air to let the starlit sky shine down on it like a kaleidoscope stuffed with universes where nobody believes in gray. And while I'm still colorblind, I've learned to pick a white rose and let its colors devour me. Thanks. So I brought something special. This was my grandma's Afghan that she made me years ago. I think she was colorblind. But I love her. Really, blue and green are my favorite colors, but the green is so bright. This has a little bit to do with the poem, but not much. The way ornaments cascade. Last June, I sat curled up in my grandma's Afghan, sipping Last June, I sat curled up in my grandma's Afghan, sipping a cup of hot chocolate on an evening lit by the pursuit of happiness. I made a Christmas wish, a summer's Christmas wish to myself for the healing that comes with forgetting. I don't remember your name. I don't remember your family, your favorite food, your birthday, not that I ever did. I've forgotten a lot of things, but the little things stick to my mind like a late November frost. For example, I remember that green coat you wore, more like sandpaper than cloth, the way that it scruffed my legs and my arms on that sleigh ride under a blanket of stars. I also remember that concert in Abravanel Hall when I wouldn't let you pay for yourself. You thought things were serious because before then, we had only played chopsticks on chain link fences. The metal rattled like a tattletale. I skipped your piano book across the river just to watch the notes spill out. I flopped like a bass clef, and you shook silver eighth notes out of your hair the way ornaments cascade from a shaking tree. Why did you trust me when I wouldn't even trust myself? I let my porcelain dreams crash on black ice like a car. I've driven myself crazy trying to fit a square and a round peg together when I forgot I needed the hole. I know I didn't believe in love until I saw the way your ragdoll head hung like a light bulb, burned out. I could have made you glow, let your Beethoven fingers shimmer on a piano outside of a piano shop, but I didn't. I couldn't feel in perfect pitch. I pitched a tent in my own backyard to hide so I didn't have to hear your knuckles rap out words in the rhythm of a sob. I robbed you of the chance to live life in more than a diminished scale. I've been through hell to know you don't have to be burned by my words. So I've learned how to say goodbye for now and ride alone on my merry-go-round. But if you don't forget me, cast me a line, a rhyme, sometime when you have time to grab a cup of hot chocolate with me and watch as the steam spirals up like a sonata, sustain, then vanish. Thank you.
Brian is taller than me. Most everybody is, though. Next, we have Tyler Esplin. Tyler was born and raised in Millville, Utah, a few miles south of Logan. He started writing in middle school, but didn't take it seriously until high school. His primary influences are the writers of the Beat Generation, most notably Ginsberg. In his poetry, he tries to convey the universal duality of holiness and dread. He is a freshman majoring in creative writing. Tyler.
All right, this poem is called Aquatic Lamps. He's like he needs a tuba solo soundtrack, following him around, howling like a pack of rabid dogs. It's like a goddamn demon-eyed naysayer pulling back his jaw and peeling up the corners of his mouth. Smile. A couple of people standing in a flip dark chill breeze on the wings of the northern wind. Spineless crowds of jellyfish floating on the Atlantic like aquatic lamps with translucent shades. Standing on street corners, blowing cigarette smoke into thin air. Angel-headed hipsters ruminating what life's all about. They don't reach no conclusions or nothing. Thank you.
All right, our last local poet for the evening is Seth Timmons. He'll be reading Want. Seth is 18 years old and originally from California. He couldn't think of a clever intro, so he would like to request that everyone think of their favorite joke and laugh. Seth Timmons.
I try. Can you hear? Can you hear? Can you hear the ice cream truck? It's playing a tune, and soon that truck will be pulling up shiny pink and chrome, all decked out with a smiling cone of vanilla right on top. The driver's gonna stop his shop on wheels, and he is gonna yell and scream his deals, and the children will come. Come, get your ice cream. We got anything you could ask for. Caramel, mint chocolate chip, pecan praline, and more. So kid, anything you imagine is what you're having, so what do you want? He's talking to me. Interesting. Well, I want a lot of things, like everyone else. I want an umbrella with me every time I'm on a walk and it starts to rain. I want those I love to never feel pain. I want a car that runs on nothing but air, a television that plays what I'm feeling, and a mood ring that tells me my girlfriend's mood. And while I'm at it, I want a flavor of ice cream that will last forever and never, ever, ever melt. And crayons, too, in every color of the rainbow. And I find those places in my life, those panels that just lost their shine over time. I find those spots with their rotting planks, and I would take my crayons and I'd fill in those blanks. And I don't need a stencil or a ruler, and I don't need instructions or Google or even the New York Times, because I am painting what I'm feeling. And I am making a work of art for my museum. And I do not care if you aren't a fan, because right here, right now, is my present. And it's a present to myself. Because the truth is, I don't care about the sprinkles. Because the truth is, I do what I want to because I want to. That's the truth. And when that ice cream truck pulls up, you can keep your sprinkles. Hold the syrup. Save the chocolate chips for a not so rainy day, because the truth is, I take walks because it's raining, and I don't want your umbrella. You can throw away the golden taste test spoons and the cheap sugar cones that come from a cold corporate factory far away in nowhere. Because deep, and I mean deep down, past the profit before the price, I know that vanilla really is my favorite. And to hell with your 31 flavors, your gourmet toppings, and your reproductions, because I want the original. So if you ask me, what do you want? I don't want a lot of things. And I don't want what everyone else is having. I just want a simple waffle cone. Hand-rolled, not boxed. And in that Dreamland certified genuine hand-rolled straight from Grand Mama's kitchen waffle cone, I want one scoop, not two. Plain, old, perfect vanilla. Thank you.